Hi, my name is Menno and you're watching the hottest LibGDX tutorial series. This is episode 5 already. And yeah, like I said, it's really hot. I'm still running my air conditioning, so I'm hoping you're not being bothered by the noise that gives. I'm running a little bit late with this video again. Anyway, I'm doing my best to release at a regular basis. We left off with assets importing and management, and in this episode we're gonna dive into screens. Now if you open the main running class, you still have all these objects sitting here. It should all actually belong to a different class, maybe not even a screen class. Like the player should probably already go to something like a world class that's responsible for drawing the world and all the entities running in it. So yeah, let's already start to remove this, and this as well. We don't need it. The texture atlas can go as well, and we won't need to load that. We just need to set the assets, to be loading and load them. The whole dispose method can actually go as well, and we're gonna extend, instead of application adapter, we're gonna extend game. And now there's a method opening for us, which is called set screen, and we could do something like new main menu screen, and we actually want to pass along the asset manager. So assets.getAsset. We can get rid of the render method as well, but we need to copy this. We need to paste this in the render method of the screen we are going to create. So I just cut this, delete the render method with IntelliJ IDE or Android Studio. You can go Alt Enter and create class main menu screen. Not an inner class, and that will be extending a screen, and it will create the asset manager class as well. But we can get rid of that as well. So now we can use the screen, and then we have to the screen implementation, but then we have to implement all its methods. There's a helper class for that in LibGDX called screen adapter. And now we just have to import the methods we actually need. So, overriding methods. Render, resize, and show. We are not interested for now in hide, pause, or resume. Pause and resume is called on your respective Android device when you change your app. So if you close, you go to home screen. The pause function is called, and resume function is called when you open up your app again. So the dispose method is still important, but we won't be using it in this tutorial. That's just it. Now we're gonna immediately paste that screen clearing code into the render method, and I'm gonna put the show method on top, which seems more logical. The show method is being called once. It's much like the create method here in game or the application adapter. It's called once. The resize is called when your screen is opening for the first time, and when you resize your window or your Android device, is going to change from portrait to landscape. We don't need these super methods from the parent screen adapter class. First we need two things. Stage. So make sure that is the proper stage. Yeah, I imported the JavaFX stage. So make sure that's the LibGDX scene2D stage. And a stage is responsible for or used to a display, a user interface, display buttons, labels, text, all kind of actors. So yeah, we're gonna use that to draw our buttons, our menu buttons, of course. And then we use a screen. A viewport. A viewport is responsible for displaying everything properly within all the different resolutions your app can run on. So just a helper class which uses a camera to display your world. And you have a couple of different viewports, like a fit viewport just fits the specified size in your screen and everything that falls out of your screen, like if you have a different screen ratio, you end up with black bars. You can also have a extend viewport that does exactly the same as the fit viewport. It just fits it, but then extends your game world into the black bars, so you get a wider or higher view of your world. Now you have a couple different viewports. You can just look them up. They all do just a little bit different different things. Now a viewport, we just call a viewport, and in the show method we're gonna set them stage equals new stage, and then we do viewport equals new, and I like the extend viewport. It's not gonna stretch in any way, and we have to specify the minimum world sizes we want to display. So like if you have a tile game, you can say, well, my tile size is 1x1. Then you can specify something like, I want to have at least 16 tiles in the width, and I want to have at least 9 tiles in the world height to be shown, at least. And then that's just gonna extend, and when you have a wider screen or screen is oriented differently, it's gonna stretch it out and show us more tiles in those black areas. But if you're gonna say, well, my tiles are like 32x32, and I'm not talking about pixels, just a convenient number for you. Most games use something that's divisible easily, or like in powers of two. So 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, up all the way up to 512,028. So, yeah, you have to decide on how, what the sizes of your world actually mean. If you're gonna use Box2D, a physics library, by default it says one, a unit of 1 equals 1 meter. You can actually change that in the engine, but then I advise to keep the default of Box2D whenever you're gonna use that. Anyway, you can fill it out like this, but this means whenever we're gonna draw a bitmap, you just a bitmap uses integers. So we just have 16 integers and 9 integers to draw our grid of our bitmap, so it's gonna be really large by default. You can actually change a scale and fiddle around with it to make it work, but we'll just go with 1280 by 720, so we don't have to deal with that. And since this is a UI, a user interface for our game, the main menu, it's better to use the amount of pixels, the resolution you are targeting for. Whenever the screen starts and when it's resized, we want that viewport to update. This is an important part. We want to update it with a new width and new height, so things don't get stretched, and the viewport is just gonna update everything for you, so it all still fits. So the stage is responsible for holding all those buttons, and we're gonna add buttons and all kind of widgets to this stage. But the stage also can act. So when we call act, it's gonna register button clicks, moving actors around, doing animations, whatever we want within our scene 2D stage to happen. It's gonna do the logic here. And like I said in the earlier videos, we want the logic first, and then we want to actually draw stage. So the stage comes with its own sprite badge. If you instantiate it like this, you can also give it a sprite badge, I believe. Yeah, here's a sprite badge. And you want to give it a viewport as well. We want the stage to be using that viewport, so we have to turn these around and give the viewport to the stage. And now we are all set to actually create some buttons. I think we want to have at least 4 buttons, and we are gonna make them all look a little bit the same. So there's a lot of lines of code that will be duplicated if we create every button by hand. So we're gonna have a public void method, or a private actually. So just this class is gonna use that private void. We're gonna return the text button as well. Text button. We're gonna create some text buttons, the scene2d type of text buttons. Private text button. We're gonna return that. Create button. Or maybe even add button. Yes, since we're gonna immediately add it to the stage, and these are gonna appear in the order from top to bottom in how we call this add button method. We do want to specify a name, so string a name to give this button. Then we can just use the stage to add that button. So we first create a new text button. Button, give it a generic name, equals new text button, since this is a generic button creation method. We specify the name. Oh, and then we need to specify a skin, right? Yeah, of course. And we didn't load that skin yet, right? No. Okay, rewind. We have to copy our skin. So, like we did earlier with the font, we need to go to the tools, your libraries, and then the GDX tools. And then here on the bottom of these tools, you find three files, a uiskin.atlas, a uiskin.skin.json, and a uiskin.png. Copy those. And I'm just gonna paste them right in the assets. You also want to, whenever you put this in a separate folder, you want the font to be in the same folder. Otherwise, your skin is gonna complain about not finding the font, since it's also using the font. This is how a skin file looks, and when you open it, so Android Studio recognizes it as a libgdx skin file. So you want to press yes, and then it's all gonna be formatted in a very nice way. You can even see what colors are being created here with the RGB values. So this is pretty good, and we are actually creating these text buttons. So, and whenever you don't specify a different style, it's gonna use a default style. So there's already a toggle style, so for the toggling button, and a default style, which is just a normal button. And we can actually also change the color to something that's over here. You can even, the IntelliJ is actually working. Like I press the R and you can see which colors. And we can add a color here, like teal or something. What did I do? It worked, right? Teal. So alpha will be one. Blue will be one. How do you make teal? Blue, one. Yeah. Red, zero. And green one. So that would make teal, right? How is this formatted? I want to have the same format. Yeah, now this is a teal, so we can actually use the teal color as well for our button. Where is our button again? So this is how the libgdx skin thing works in a nutshell. So let's go up and continue with our skin file to load it. We have to get our assets thing, and now to load the skin file, it's a little bit different. We do a public static final asset descriptor as well. Then we're gonna say we want to load the skin, not the JavaFX skin, a libgdx scene2d skin. We're gonna call it skin, and gonna set that to an asset descriptor, and then it's in the root. So we need uiskin.json, the JSON file is a skin file. Then we're gonna specify skin.class. And then we have to say, we still have to specify the atlas this skin is linked to. So we do that with a skin loader. Skin parameters. We have to call new on that, I believe. New skin parameters. Yeah, now it's asking us for the string to the texture atlas, which is also in the root assets folder, so you set them a working folder, which is uiskim.atlas, and this should actually work. In our load all method, you can also ask the asset manager to queue up that skim file for loading. We need private asset manager, and then in our constructor, we're gonna ask and fill that asset manager in, and now we can have a skin, since this is the stage is gonna use skin a lot, so we are not gonna ask the asset manager to look up the skin file in its assets every time. We're gonna load it in immediately when we are setting it. So skin equals asset manager dot get, and then we're gonna ask our public static skin descriptor for the actual skin, and we're gonna fill in skin there on the button. So yeah, that was a little bit of a detour. Now the button is created. Now we want to add that to a table, so we're gonna create a main table, private table. That's also a C2D thing, table. I'm just gonna call it main table, and in the show method I'm also gonna create it, fill that main table. Main table equals new table, and then I'm gonna set its size as large as its parent, which is the stage. Not yet. Here, stage dot add actor. We're gonna add that main table to the stage, so its parent is the stage, and we can say main table dot set fill parent to true. And now it grows, the table grows towards the maximum size of our stage. Okay, now we can add the button to that main table, maintable.add button. And we're gonna return this button because you can click this, but something needs to happen. We still have to assign a listener, a click listener, and within that click listener, we have to code in some functionality as to what's gonna happen when someone clicks that button. Now in our show method, we're gonna create some buttons and see what happens. So you're just gonna call add button, and then what will we want? You want to have a play button. Let's copy this a couple times. We want to have options button, and we want to have a credits button. Credits are all yours, guys, and we want to have a quit button. This should actually run. Somehow my play button was grayed out, but I restarted Android Studio, and this should work now. All right, there are our buttons, but they are not functional at all. We need to set the stage as a input. The stage is an input listener, but we have to specify to GDX what it's gonna be listening to. So GDX.input.set the input processor. So we're just gonna fill in the stage here. So now the stage is being used for recognizing passes and stuff. So yeah, there we go. It's great, but still the buttons still need a listener attached to them in order to give them different functionality. And yeah, we want to have them from top to bottom, and maybe give them the same size, so it looks a little bit nicer and space them out a little bit more. So let's try that. Since we have created a method for our generic buttons, we can just set it here. So main table.add, I think we have to use the fill. Fill X. We want to fill it on X, and then we want to do some padding on the button. Pad button, like, I don't know, 10. Just filling in some random stuff. Anyway, I'm just going with this for now, and then we need to set the main table to add a new row. So the next button that's going to be created is going to be on the next row within this table. Now let's see what's happening. All right, well, this looks a lot better. You can even grow this a little bit more. Let's just hard code a size. You can also hard code the size. So then, oh yeah, of course you need that button. You do need. Then you don't need to fill x, I think. But size a bit, I think. Yeah, something like our screen world width is 1280. So, like I said, if I make this 1280, our buttons will be the width of our screen. Promise you. Like that. You can even see the curved end of the button here. So it's exactly 1280. So it looks actually not bad. But let's make it a little bit bigger, like 700. Big buttons. Like, let's make it make them a little bit higher. So the height, let's make that, I think 80 is gonna be a lot bigger. Yeah, and then make the space, yeah, that's maybe it's too big. So, but we're not doing a UI design tutorial, but I think this is looking nice. Yeah, this is looking nice. You can't misclick those buttons. So for the last part of this episode, we're gonna attach some listeners to our buttons. In order to give them some functionality when they are clicked. Now, I'm just gonna do the quit and the play button, but the play button is just gonna signal, since we don't have a play screen yet, it's just gonna signal a message to the console. Since this is returning a button, I can just do .addListener, new clickListener. We added here a clickListener and a clickListener. And you press Alt Insert has a lot of override methods here. So this is going to be called whenever a touchdown on this button has been done, whenever a mouse exits the button. But we are interested in a click, so we're just going to override the click. We're going to delete the super method, and we're going to say something like so. The play has been clicked. Enjoy. And then we're gonna do the same to .addListener to the quit button, new click listener. Alright, that went wrong. We have to do there and close it there. It looks a little bit weird, but you have to, you just create a new object here, but because we are opening these brackets here, we can change that object right in the code here. So just override it. So it's the same as we are doing here. We are extending the screen adapter and overriding its show functionality. So yeah, your code goes in the in between these brackets and then override, or you can just go clicked here and override the click method, and then we're gonna ask gdx.input. No, not input, but app.exit. Yes, that's it. And we're gonna do a little message as well. So, bye bye. Oh, bye. So now we're gonna test this out and see if it works. So, play is gonna be showing us this message. And quit is quitting the game. Bye bye. Now, this is the end of the fifth episode now. I hope you enjoyed it. So you really help me out if you click the like button. Also subscribe if you want to be informed of new videos. And yeah, I love you guys. And I hope I see you in the next episode. Bye bye.